What started as a two-year secretarial college for women is now Maryland's fastest-growing four-year independent university. Sarah Caldwell interviewed the president of Stevenson University, Dr. Kevin Manning, and she spoke with the head football coach there. Later, former Detroit Mayor Kwame Kilpatrick stops by to tell us about his new book entitled Surrendered, The Rise and Fall and Revelation of Kwame Kilpatrick. I'm Lisa Robinson. All this and more on this edition of 11 TV Hill.
Stevenson University's career-focused programs are the formula for success for many graduates. Joining us today is Stevenson University President Dr. Kevin Manning. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, exciting things happening there. Tell us how you transformed your vision into a reality.
Well, you know, about 10 years ago, we were looking to expand the campus to become a residential campus, and we looked at some property and decided on an area of Owings Mills. And over the past 6 years, we've built $150 million worth of residence halls and academic buildings in Owings Mills, about 6 miles from our main campus.
And it's now attracting attention nationwide. Tell us about your student body.
Well, we now have more residential students than we have commuter students. So we have about 1,800 residential students. We have a record enrollment. We have 3,200 full-time students on campus. So we've doubled in size in the past 11 years. And now we're attracting students from all over the region, from the lacrosse team, for example. The men's lacrosse team attracts students from all over the country, and the university itself attracts students from the middle Atlantic states, from Connecticut, New Jersey, New York, and places like that.
And it's a really unique place because it's not only focusing on academics, but career and getting you on that path to a job.
Right. One of our goals is to be a national leader in career education. We have 6 schools, but as part of the academic experience, we also have a thing called career architecture. And what we're trying to do is help students to learn how to design their career rather than just get into a job when they graduate from college. And it's of real interest to parents and students, and especially in this job market.
Yeah, I was going to say, how difficult is it right now with the job market to really have good job placement?
Well, we've seen some challenges over the last several years. You know, we've consistently placed about 95% of our students in jobs or graduate school at the end of 4 years. We've seen a slight decrease in that, but we're still doing pretty well because of the nature of our curriculum.
What else does Stevenson University have that makes it different from everywhere else?
Well, I would say that some of the programs that we have, for example, like the nursing program and education, a lot of these career-oriented kinds of things are a little bit unique in terms of higher education. We also have a pretty extensive athletics program now, and one of the interesting things that we're doing, which we find pretty special, is we're starting a women's ice hockey team.
Really?
So we will be, we think, we'll be the southernmost university in America to have an ice hockey program because, you know, here we are in the South a little bit. And we just hired 2 coaches from Canada, 2 women from Canada who are going to be the coach and assistant coach for the women's ice hockey team. We think it's going to be pretty interesting.
That is really exciting. I would imagine it will generate a lot of interest, too. How about the football program? This is new for you guys. You guys are now a force to be reckoned with on the gridiron. How did that come about?
And don't forget the marching band.
Of course.
We have a marching band now, too. Yeah. So the football team, we began to look at this about 4 years ago. Everybody thought we were crazy when we decided we were going to do this. We made a recommendation to the Board of Trustees. They accepted the recommendation. We hired Ed Hottle, who you'll talk to, and he came from Gallaudet in D.C. Last year was a practice year. This year is the first year of the program. We built a new 3,500-seat stadium. So the most exciting thing for us is the first game, first home game, we actually won, which we were shocked about and happy for.
And that's where you want that to happen.
And that's where we want it to happen. And we have it all on tape so we can do all the highlight films.
Great.
But it was a pretty special moment.
Yeah. What other things do we have to look forward to this year at Stevenson?
Well, we continue to expand. We just built 2 new residence halls. We're now looking at constructing some more buildings on campus. We're adding new majors. For example, we're going to put a new program in fashion design and interior design, which are programs that really don't exist to any great extent in Maryland right now, especially the interior design program. So what we're looking for are a variety of career-oriented programs that will help our students get jobs at the end of 4 years.
And it must be an interesting experience for you, considering all the transformation that's happened over the years. How did you come to Stevenson?
Well, I've spent 45 years in higher education. I started in 1967, and I came from Philadelphia. I was a vice president for development at Immaculata University in Philly, was looking for a presidency. They offered me the job. I came in 2000. Mm-hmm. So it's really it's a real honor to be a president of Stevenson University. And we kind of consider the whole thing that's happening at Stevenson to be like a historic time. You know, every organization has about 10 or 15 years of real change and transformation, and that's where we are right now at Stevenson. So it's exciting.
And if we get a snapshot of the student body and we talk to them and their experience there, what would they tell us?
Well, they're very, very happy to be at Stevenson. I mean, it's a special place. It's very welcoming. The faculty really pay attention to the students and give them a lot of academic support. And the parents that come on campus, somebody was just telling us a story about a parent that just couldn't stop talking about his son, who's a freshman at Stevenson, and how much they love the experience.
And that says a lot about your work there. So yeah,
thanks. Well, it's a lot of people are working hard.
Absolutely. And we appreciate you taking the time to talk to us. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having me,
Thanks
Sarah.
So much.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Coming up next, are you ready for some football? Ed Hottle joins us. Don't go away. You're watching 11 TV Hill. Stevenson University has a brand new stadium and a brand new football team. Joining us today is head coach Ed Hottle. Welcome. Thanks so much for being with
us.
Thank you. This is really exciting. I would imagine a labor of love for you. How did it come about?
Stevenson did a national search looking for the first ever football coach, and I was fortunate enough to get the job and literally started with a laptop, a cell phone, and a credit card, and have built a football program from scratch.
And how do you go about doing that? I mean, what are you telling these players? You don't have a record to talk about.
No record, no stadium, no helmet, no uniforms.
Right.
You're selling a dream. Very much of the dream that became a reality this past fall with the inaugural season, the first game. And we sold that in concept to a bunch of young men that have bought in and done a good job.
Now, you came from a different university with a different set of challenges. Tell us about that.
I spent 5 years as the head football coach at Gallaudet University, and Gallaudet is the national leader in deaf education. Mm-hmm. All of our play calling, all of our practices, everything was done in American Sign Language, so it was a unique experience.
Yeah. Now, what challenges do you have, aside from just the fact that this is a brand new program here?
Lots of challenges. These young men are going through what is, a difficult time in their lives, going off to college, moving out of their homes for the first time, but also moving into an ultra-competitive environment, an environment that demands a lot of them emotionally, physically, and mentally, and asking them, oh, by the way, you've got to be a great college student as well. So it's a difficult transition when you start to put all of these things together. And, and our job right now is to kind of get them over the hump, get them feeling comfortable in the classroom, getting them feeling comfortable on the field, and being competitive all at the same time. So it's an interesting process and how guys of varying maturity levels will handle the different facets of what we do and how they handle their transition from not only living in the home and going to high school, but transitioning into a college environment. It's very, very interesting and can be challenging from time to time.
Now, you've had a few games. You're 1-4 so far.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So things are off to kind of a slow start, but that's what you would expect, I would imagine.
Yep. Our growth is incremental at this point. Every Saturday we go out and we are getting better, and it's difficult, for outsiders to see, our guys are two steps closer to making that play, and then the next week they're one step closer, and watching them evolve as college athletes and really breaking down their performance into literally step-by-step progress. For us, it's very exciting. It's very rewarding as a coach. And it's part of the process, and it's part of what you have to go through to get to that level that we aspire to be.
Right, and as Dr. Manning said, you guys won the home game, mm-hmm. which is really the game you want to win, and you won it in dramatic fashion. There was like a flea flicker. It was sudden death. Tell us about that moment.
Very stressful. I know it was made for great entertainment, but from where I was sitting, I would have rather it ended a lot sooner than it did. The guys did a great job. They responded to some adversity throughout the game and being able to push it into double overtime with a 37-yard field goal with 1 second on the clock from a freshman kicker. Was a pretty remarkable thing to watch. And then as we gained confidence as we went through the overtime and then to ultimately win it was a great reward for our guys and a lot of the hard work that they've done. And it was almost surreal, but from a coaching and a player perspective, it's you get to enjoy it for about 4 hours and you're on to the next one. So I think as we wind down the season and start looking at recruiting, we'll go back and actually have an opportunity to watch that TV broadcast and kind of relive and savor that moment. But for right now, it's business as usual. It's on to the next
right.
week.
Now, you have to be at somewhat of an advantage, though, because folks come in to face you guys and they're probably underestimating you.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, and we're working for respect, you know, because we are who we are, and people do look at us that way, and that's okay, because that it's going to turn around, and our guys know where we stand, and they know that every time we take the field, we're looking to earn respect from our opponents, and ultimately it's going to happen.
And you have to be earning respect within the student body at Stevenson University. How have they received the football team?
They've been fantastic. Thousands of them showed up for the first home game. The following Saturday, thousands more showed up, and you know, it was a pretty neat thing to watch. After we won in the overtime, our guys go over and, you know, slapping high fives with the students in the crowd, and they did a great job. They were loud, and they got after it a little bit, and it was very, very exciting to see our entire community, our student body, our football program really come together and you know, and work toward a common goal. And it was very exciting because they worked hard too. You know, it's hard work being loud for 3.5 hours.
Yeah. What's the most inspiring thing watching your team develop? It's got to be it touches your heart to see the heart that they have.
Well, it's the adversity and watching them grow literally every day. You know, every day we go in and we watch practice. We film everything that we do, and we sit down as a staff, and I ask the question, and I think the staff gets tired of hearing it, but did we get better today? And if, as long as we can answer that question with yes, in some aspect we got better today, and knowing ultimately that we're moving toward, you know, our goal of winning a conference championship and a national championship, that's very important and special to me, and it helps me sleep the little bit I do get to sleep at nighttime.
Yeah. What other long-term goals do you have? I know you're always focusing on just the next game, but in terms of developing your team in the long run,
we want to be successful consistently. That's our number one goal, is, you know, to be year in and year out a nationally ranked and respected football program, and one that, you know, people feel like they better bring their A game, you know, when you're going to play Stevenson. And that's where we want to be, and you know, along those lines is we want to turn out quality young men. We want young men that can leave our institution and go into the community and be leaders. And take the experiences they've learned on the field in a team environment and apply them to their professional lives down the road. And, you know, both of those goals are really hand in hand.
Dr. Manning brought in a bobblehead that he's very excited about that apparently is gaining some national recognition. So that's pretty cool. You guys are being talked about.
Yes, it's exciting. Our bobbleheads appear on the Mike and Mike Show on ESPN every morning, and it's a pretty neat thing to not only see that little piece of it, but, you know, get contacts from kids in California that have somehow gotten the word about Stevenson and are interested in coming, you know, just to visit from California to see what we have going on and looking at our athletic facilities and what we offer, you know, from an institutional perspective. It's pretty exciting.
Must be. What have you learned from this whole experience so far?
Patience. You know, we have to remind ourselves that these are freshmen and they are going through a lot mentally, emotionally, academically, and, you know, we have to be patient with them, and again, there's a process that they're all going through, and you know, sometimes we forget the competitive drive that we have as coaches and as players too. You know, they get impatient with each other, so, you know, we talk about that, about going through the process and the value of this experience is in the journey.
Cool. We appreciate you coming in,
Thank you very much.
Hope to welcome you back with a championship
next time. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Thanks so much.
Kwame Kilpatrick was the youngest and the first African-American mayor to lead the city of Detroit. Although the city was thriving with new businesses and big-ticket entertainment, his personal life was overshadowed in the press by scandal, and he joins us today to tell us about his new book entitled Surrendered, The Rise and Fall and Revelation of Kwame Kilpatrick. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Lisa.
You've been through something.
Something is an understatement. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have.
So tell me about this book and why you decided to write it.
Well, Surrendered, The Rise, Fall, and Revelation of Kwame Kilpatrick is basically a story about my life, mm-hmm. How I came through being a regular Detroit kid to going off to college and law school and being the first African-American and youngest person to lead the state house, mm-hmm. to being mayor, and then going into prison, solitary mm. confinement, maximum security, mm-hmm. You know, what that was like, being on a prison yard. Mm-hmm. Going from Air Force One, talking Monday Night Football with mm-hmm. President Clinton, or Oval Office with President Bush, and then being in solitary confinement or a max prison cell with a triple murderer, mm-hmm. and everything in between. But also, it takes you inside the bedroom, the mm-hmm. conversations with my wife and my children during the scandalous time of my life as well. And so, I wrote this book as a testimony, as a first healing for myself and mm-hmm. my family, but then a testimony that I hope will help someone else.
All right, you're airing a lot of the laundry that was already out there, and some of us heard, you know, certainly the scandal was everywhere. Mm-hmm. What happened?
Well, what happened was, and first of all, you know, what was already out there was the side of people that weren't me. This is the first time I've talked about it at all. And what happened is I cheated on my wife, you know, and I lied about it in a court of law. And I had to be punished for that. I was punished more severely than anybody in American history by the criminal justice system. I was sent to prison for a crime that I was recommended to have probation for. And the judge went outside the guidelines and gave me 18 months to 5 years for that. But I went without crying, murmuring, because I felt guilty. I felt condemned. I felt that I hurt my wife, mom, the city so bad that I should take it. And that's what happened. You know, there were a lot of speculation and innuendos and other stories that surfaced that turned out later to not be true. But I gave them the rope to essentially hang me. And that's what I talk about. And I talk about the process of getting up from that concrete floor in the solitary confinement cell and coming back to Baltimore and sitting on the set with Lisa.
Okay, so you know, how did you, so your marriage survived this?
Yes, by the grace of God, through hell and high water, Carlita Kilpatrick is still my wife, and we're closer than we ever been, best friends. And that's also something. She wrote the epilogue in the book. A lot of women want to know, why does she stay with him? And I don't believe she knows or I know, except for the incredible power of our God. But at the same time, through that fire, it shaped and molded us into a different relationship where the brutal honesty helped us. And it also is making us better parents and better lovers for one another.
And when this was, you were going through this, people were like, man, doesn't he know better than to send text messages?
Yeah, you know, you could be so bright. I graduated with honors from college, and law school, and all these, and I'm stupid too. You know, the inconsistencies that dwell within all of us. You know, I met a doctor the other day who smoked like a chimney. We have some inconsistencies, and one of them, I could be very bright and move a city forward and build things and bring in events and run city services very well. And on the other end, I can do something stupid, revolutionarily stupid, like send text messages. And have an affair. And so that is the inconsistency that I speak of in detail in the book. And I take you inside step by step. I you know, most people have said that I told too much in this book. And I think it's important that if you're going to write a book, be honest.
All right. And so how are you dealing with it with your extended family? Your mother lost her election bid, and many blamed it on you.
I was at Empowerment Temple last night. Over with Pastor Jamal Bryant, and my mother came over from D.C. and sat in the front row, and this is one of the things that we discussed there last night. There were a lot of very painful things that happened throughout this last 15 months, now 18 months. And one of the most painful was watching my mother, who served the city of Detroit and her congressional district. She served for more than 32 years, lose a seat because of her son. And then she says her baby boy. You know, I sat in a prison bunk listening to the returns come in and heard my mother lost the race. And it was profoundly painful. And my mother came to visit that next weekend. Of course, election is on a Tuesday. And Friday, she came to visit me. And when I went out, I couldn't hardly face her. It was one of the most painful things that I ever had to do, you know. And she looked me right in the eye and she said, son, I finished my course. And she accepted it in a way that it blew me away. And and from that moment, her life has really taken off in the way that she wants. She has more time to spend with her grandchildren. She has two retirements from the State House in Michigan and from the federal government. She's happier than I've ever seen her. But it's those type of events that I write about in the book that I think helps mothers heal. It helps sons, but it also helps families understand that you go through some things, but you got to shake off the guilt and condemnation and move forward.
Your legal troubles are not over. What are you facing right now?
Well, we have some federal charges that we're facing in the city of Detroit. You know, they have extended out the time. It was going to go this March, then next March, and now in next October. I think it'll be pushed back further. One of the things that this so-called, this scandal started was a lot of rumor, speculation, and innuendo. And a lot of the text messages that were released, they were released to a small group of people. And a lot of speculation was surrounding the text messages of things that he may have done. And those took on a life of their own in a lot of the rumor world and press world. And I believe those charges came out of that. Mm-hmm. The more that there's an investigation, the more that they see that those things didn't happen. And I think we'll be okay. It's just the point that you got to continue to go through it. And I hate that the city of Detroit is dragged through it. I haven't been mayor in 3 years. And I'm still on the news every other day in the city of Detroit. It is hard for the city to move forward in the midst of them talking about a dead thing. Kwame Kilpatrick is gone. The city needs life.
We're almost out of time, but I want to ask you, a lot of times when something bad happens, I always tell people the swelling will go down. And so how long did that take for you to get past it, and how do you get past it?
You know, one of the things people have to determine for themselves, within themselves, that they free before they see it. You got to believe it before you see it. And so that happened for me, actually, in solitary confinement. I was punished far worse than anybody has ever been punished. They put me in a minimum security guard, never been in trouble in my life, in solitary in a max prison. But sitting there after I went crazy for about 10 days, Lisa, I started to feel a freedom that I've never felt before. And I determined at that point on the floor, feeling like an abysmal failure, that I had to get up. And that's the moment where it started to turn around.
And so you're getting up with this book and you're going around touring talking about
Absolutely.
It.
I've been through several colleges and was at Empowerment Temple last night, and it's time to get up. And now I'm here with Lisa.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Good luck with
you.
Everything.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me.
And don't go away. You're watching 11 TV Hill. Thanks for watching 11 TV Hill. If you would like information on today's show, simply visit our website, WBALTV.com. And as always, stay tuned to the news that is live, local, and late breaking. I'm Lisa Robinson. Have a great day.